Breaking discovery, ancient water technology that could save modern coastal cities. How did an ancient Persian port city thrive in one of the most water-scarce regions on Earth? With wells deeper than a 40-story building and engineering that still baffles modern experts. Along the sun-baked shores of the Persian Gulf, where the azure waters meet an unforgiving landscape, lie the ruins of one of history's most remarkable forgotten cities. Over 1,000 years ago, as Europe stumbled through its dark ages, this bustling metropolis served as a crucial nexus of international trade, connecting China and India to the markets of Mesopotamia and beyond. Ships from distant lands unloaded precious cargoes of spices, silks, and jewels on its wharfs, while merchants speaking a dozen languages haggled in its markets. Yet, this thriving center of commerce and culture arose in a place where nature seemed to forbid human habitation. A harsh coastal desert where fresh water, the very lifeblood of civilization, was almost nowhere to be found. Today, we explore the ingenuity and determination of a people who refused to accept the limitations of their environment, as we uncover the extraordinary water engineering secrets of none other than the lost city of Siraf. This ancient city represents one of humanity's greatest triumphs over environmental adversity. While most coastal settlements throughout history enjoyed abundant fresh water, Siraf's founders faced an almost impossible challenge. Building a major international port in a location where rainfall was scarce and surface water practically non-existent. Their solution? Perhaps the most sophisticated water harvesting system of the ancient world. At the heart of this marvel were the city's stone wells. No ordinary wells by any measure. Imagine workers over 1,000 years ago using nothing but hand tools, carving through solid rock to create shafts, plunging an astonishing 130 meters underground. That's equivalent to the height of a 40-story skyscraper, but going down instead of up. These weren't simple holes in the ground. They were masterpieces of precision engineering, with perfectly vertical walls that maintained their integrity century after century. But the wells were just one component of a much larger integrated system. Siraf's water engineers implemented the kanat technology, a Persian innovation that changed the face of arid lands across the Middle East and beyond. These kanats were underground aqueducts, carefully angled tunnels that tapped into the water table and used gravity alone to bring precious moisture to the surface. What makes Siraf's kanats extraordinary was their integration with the coastal terrain and the way they prevented saltwater intrusion, a problem that challenges even modern coastal water systems. The city's water catchment areas represented another stroke of genius. While rainfall was minimal, when it did come, not a single drop was wasted. The surrounding hills were modified with subtle channels and collection points that directed rainfall towards storage areas. Small dams and diversion structures, nearly invisible to the casual observer, transformed the landscape into a vast water collection machine that activated during the rare precipitation events. Once captured, water needed proper storage. Siraf's engineers created massive underground cisterns carved from the living rock. These chambers weren't merely functional, they were architectural masterpieces with vaulted ceilings and columns that distributed structural forces perfectly. The interior surfaces were sealed with a waterproof mortar whose exact composition continues to puzzle modern scientists. The brilliance of Siraf's water system wasn't just in its physical infrastructure, but in how it operated within such a challenging environment. Archaeological evidence suggests the city employed a sophisticated seasonal management approach. During the sparse winter rains, every catchment system activated, channeling precious water into storage. But the true ingenuity emerged during the brutal summer months when temperatures regularly exceeded 45 degrees Celsius, 130 degrees Fahrenheit, and rainfall was non-existent for months. The city's engineers designed the entire system to minimize evaporation. A stark contrast to the open-air aqueducts favored by Romans and other civilizations blessed with more abundant water. Water management in Siraf wasn't merely a technical achievement, but a social one. Records indicate the existence of a specialized class of water managers, the marab, who oversaw distribution and settled disputes. This reveals a complex social organization where water rights were carefully allocated and protected. Unlike many ancient societies where water access created stark inequalities, evidence from Siraf suggests a more equitable distribution system, with public access points throughout the city ensuring that even the poorest residents received their share. Maintaining such an intricate water network required extraordinary skill and constant vigilance. Specialized professions emerged. Well cleaners who descended the treacherous 130-meter shafts, canal inspectors who crawled through miles of underground tunnels, and masons who repaired the stone channels with specialized waterproof mortars. These weren't merely jobs, but respected vocations passed down through generations, each with its own techniques and tools specifically adapted for Siraf's unique system. Have you ever wondered how a civilization without modern technology could possibly maintain such deep wells and extensive underground networks without them collapsing or becoming contaminated? Well, let me know what you think in the comments below. Archaeological excavations have revealed evidence of specialized tools unlike those found elsewhere. Bronze scrapers designed to remove mineral buildup, specialized ropes that resisted the damaging effects of salt water, and unique ceramic vessels shaped specifically for water quality testing. These artifacts suggest a level of professional specialization centered around water management that rivaled any contemporary civilization. Perhaps most fascinating is how Siraf's water system integrated with its identity as a bustling port. The city's engineers created a dual-purpose infrastructure where some water storage facilities could be quickly converted to hold goods during peak trading seasons. Rectangular graves carved into stone foothills served a dual function. Beyond their funerary purpose, they connected to the water management system, demonstrating how thoroughly water considerations permeated every aspect of urban planning. When compared to other Persian water systems, Siraf stands apart. While inland cities like Isfahan and Yazid developed their own impressive canal systems, Siraf had to contend with the additional challenge of saltwater intrusion. The proximity to the sea meant that overpumping fresh water could draw in seawater, a problem that continues to plague coastal cities today. Archaeologists have discovered evidence of sophisticated monitoring systems, including what appear to be early salinity testing stations, suggesting the engineers understood this complex hydrological challenge and developed methods to address it. Siraf's adaptation to its specific geographical challenges offers further insights into Persian ingenuity. The city's water system wasn't imported wholesale from elsewhere, but carefully adapted to its unique conditions. The wells varied in depth depending on the specific geology beneath each part of the city. Wind patterns were studied and exploited, with ventilation shafts placed to maximize air circulation while minimizing dust contamination. Another example of how thoroughly the engineers understood and worked with their environment. The sophisticated water systems of Siraf reveal more than engineering prowess. They offer profound insights into Persian civilization itself. Water in ancient Persia wasn't merely a physical resource, but carried deep spiritual significance. Zoroastrianism, the region's dominant faith during Siraf's heyday, considered water a sacred element that should never be polluted. This religious reverence translated into practical conservation ethics that permeated society. The city's water features weren't just utilitarian, but often incorporated beautiful decorative elements that celebrated water's spiritual importance. A perfect marriage of the practical and transcendent. Archaeological evidence suggests that Siraf's water ceremonies marked important calendar events, with certain cisterns designated for ritual purposes. Artifacts recovered from these locations include ceremonial vessels, distinctly different from everyday water containers. These findings indicate that Siraf's inhabitants maintained a relationship with water that transcended mere consumption. They honored the life-giving force that made their improbable city possible. The economic implications of Siraf's water management cannot be overstated. Without its sophisticated water system, this global trading hub simply couldn't have existed. Historical records indicate that at its peak, Siraf handled trade valued at over 2.5 million gold dinars annually. An astronomical sum in medieval terms, the stable water supply enabled everything from shipbuilding, which required significant water resources for wood treatment, to dyeing industries that process imported textiles. The city's water infrastructure directly underpinned its economic miracle. Perhaps Siraf's most enduring legacy lies in how its water technologies spread through medieval trade networks. Merchants who visited the city witnessed its water management solutions and carried this knowledge back to their homelands. Archaeological evidence shows similar systems appearing in distant ports across the Indian Ocean trading network, often decades after they were established in Siraf. The city became a knowledge hub as well as a commercial center, with its water engineering concepts disseminated across the medieval world. The study of Siraf's eventual decline offers sobering lessons. Around the 11th century, a combination of earthquakes damaged the delicate water infrastructure, while political instability disrupted the maintenance regimes that kept the system functioning. Without constant care, sections of the Connaught network collapsed, wells silted up, and the intricate balance that prevented saltwater intrusion failed. What took centuries to perfect unraveled in decades. A stark reminder that even the most brilliant engineering requires sustained social organization to survive. Today's archaeological investigation of these systems employs cutting-edge technology. Ground-penetrating radar reveals hidden channels and structures without excavation. Chemical analysis of sediments helps reconstruct water quality and usage patterns. Isotope studies of preserved organic materials reveals details about water sources and seasonal variations. Through these methods, we're still uncovering Siraf's secrets nearly a millennium after its decline. The lessons of Siraf resonate powerfully in our water-stressed world. Modern coastal cities facing freshwater challenges are increasingly looking to ancient solutions. The concept of integrated water management, capturing, storing, and distributing water while maintaining its quality, forms the backbone of sustainable water practices today. Engineers studying Siraf's methods have identified principles that could help address water scarcity in similar environments, proving that sometimes the past contains solutions to present challenges. Siraf's legacy reminds us that human ingenuity can overcome seemingly impossible environmental constraints when supported by appropriate social structures and cultural values. In a world increasingly defined by water scarcity, the whispered lessons from this ancient Persian port grow more valuable with each passing day. If you've enjoyed learning about Siraf's remarkable water systems, please hit the like button and subscribe for more explorations of ancient engineering marvels. What ancient technology would you like to see covered next? Let us know in the comments. And as always, thanks for joining us down the rabbit hole.